Here we go. We're live. So, Jim, thank you for inviting me to your show here in Boston. This is shaping up to be a really interesting week. I really appreciate the opportunity to come and see what you guys are doing.
Yeah, glad to have you here. I think we're up over 20% every year. We got a ton of people. It was daunting walking on stage for the first time and seeing that many people out there. It's great to have you here.
You guys have really grown over the last 10 years. I remember when I sort of first got 2005, and we were working on some of the projects. What was it? Libvirt was our preferred project around sort of management of virtualization, things like that. And we went to a few of your shows. Things have changed.
It's amazing to see. You know, I think over that, because I joined 9.5 years ago, right around that period of time. And you know, back then, open source was about creating open source kind of versions of software that already existed. But you know, in the last 7 or 8 years is, you know, Web 2.0 and cloud have taken off. Mm-hmm. I'd argue most net new innovations happening in open source. And so, you know, we're, to some extent, I know we've been successful, but a lot of that's right place at the right time as a company that can take all that phenomenal innovation and make it consumable for an enterprise.
Well, it's interesting because the last 10 years have really seen the rise of cloud computing, and Linux in particular has become the de facto operating system for anything you want to deploy in the cloud. And you guys have kind of ridden that cloud wave better than most, I would say.
Yeah, we've had an opportunity to do that, and certainly because most innovation now is happening on top of Linux, you know, I think we're naturally very well positioned to do that. And again, we have a big customer base and just such deep capabilities over the key projects that we've just been really well positioned for.
So I see there's a number of announcements you guys are making this week. A few caught my eye. I heard the word container mentioned, I think, 36 times in the previous press release or press conference.
Which is that all?
I think I counted three dozen. I could have been off.
I hope you were off. So you said 50 minutes.
Oh, 50. So it's funny because container seems to be the term du jour. You know, for some of us who have been around for a while, it's been around for a while. It's certainly in some ways not a new concept, but I think the way it's been implemented is very much new. You know, around this idea of microservices, you know, this kind of ability to fast flux, you know, a lot of machines for a short period of time. You know, where do you guys see this in sort of as, you know, the enterprise adopts this type of technology, container or microservices, that sort of thing?
Well, I can answer that a lot of ways, and I'm passionate about it, so cut me off when you want me to stop on it. So we are really excited about containers. It's one of these rare technologies that, you know, dramatically reduces the cost of deployment because it's so lean and lightweight, but it also makes it much more efficient for developers to develop. So it's one of these technologies that breaks a compromise. It's like efficient to build and for a developer, but it's efficient to operate. You put that together, it's just really, it's a fundamentally changing technology in terms of what you know, an enterprise can do in terms of innovation at a cost level, which is incredible. Now for us, you know, containers are Linux, right? I mean, the concern I have, a lot of people look and say, well, containers is a form of virtualization. And to some extent, there's a part of that that's true, but recognize containers basically splits the operating system into the kernel space, which is in the lightweight underneath kind of the containers, and then the user space is in the containers. And really thinking hard about how you lifecycle the user space. You know, the glibc bug was literally in every container in existence. And so how do you want to think about things like exactly that, lifecycling the container? It's not just application logic in it, it's a big component of the operating system as well. So thinking about those things, or for instance, you know, about 18 months ago, we acquired a company called Ansible, the Ansible project. And you know, it's turned out to be a great standalone business around automation. But you know, one of the reasons we did it is when you start thinking about, well, how are you gonna do automation at a container level? And you know, the traditional technologies that virtualization put, but are you gonna have every microservice with its own agent? And how fat does that get? So you need agentless automation and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So there's so much value, so many problems yet to be solved, and we're trying to look ahead and be involved in some of those. And obviously, given that, you know, C groups and SE Linux and so many of the foundations of containers are things that Red Hat leads, we're kind of right in the center of all of it.
You know, one of the challenges I think the container world has faced, I won't name any names, but has been revenue and monetization of this type of technology. probably the largest startup has struggled, to say the least. And I think I saw a press release earlier today naming a new CEO. You know, what do you think some of these challenges, you know, are, and how do we overcome them?
Well, you know, this is one of the things that I've preached for years as just the CEO of the largest open source company. As a matter of fact, I used to do every quarter, I would do an open source CEO dinner. I've kind of gotten out of doing that. I should get back into doing that. You know, open source has this wonderful power as a development model. But, you know, from a commercial perspective, you know, the fact that, you know, the IP is free is a little bit of a bug, right? Mm-hmm. And so what we found is the best way to monetize open source is to create runtimes, because enterprises want support of a runtime. So it's very hard to sell a feature or a framework, because, you know, what are you really selling if that's just IP? People aren't going to pay for free IP, it's free. But if you can say, okay, here's a runtime, or here's a set of certified services that run, and so buy this from me because you know things will work, we look for those types of things. So, like, for instance, our container platform, it's a container platform, it's not components of a container platform, because you put the whole thing together and we think that's something that's monetizable. And so I do think one of the places we could still use more innovation is open source business models. Ours works really, really well for us, but to some extent we have to look for categories where our business model will work. There's a reason we don't commercialize a lot of things in open source, because we just don't think they work with our business model.
You know, it certainly seems to be a challenge, and a lot of the, you know, the companies in the space looking to sort of fill this sort of missing feature of a given platform are almost doomed to become the feature of the platform in which they're trying to, you know, solve the missing feature of. So it's interesting you mentioned, you know, create a sustainable business, something that actually is a value beyond just being the missing piece. You know, I think a lot of people who have built services around other cloud platforms have realized the same thing. You know, taking the conversation to another direction, you know, there's been a lot of talk around things like AI, and it's almost become the sort of all-encompassing term of 2017, so like the new cloud of sorts.
Yeah.
You know, another interesting trend is around sort of the automation of infrastructure. You know, what are your opinions on how things like AI can sort of, you know, benefit, you know, adaptive, automated infrastructure type deployments?
Well, let me answer the question you didn't ask first. That's a typical pivot. I promise I'll get to your question. But this is, like, I think one of the things that's so cool to me about AI is I think it's the first time that large enterprise companies, technology companies, realize the importance of open source and communities. So you had Google and Microsoft and Facebook, everybody tripping over themselves to be the first to open source their AI engine and get more people involved and more people involved. And the thing I think is so cool about that is all of a sudden people realize that having a bigger community was really, really, really important. As a matter of fact, they're willing to invest in it and try to get there and try to do it. So it wasn't just like, well, I'm going to open source it because open source is cool, or I'm going to open source it because customers want choice. It was a first time I've truly seen that these big, massive companies realize community is really important and I need to invest in it and get there. And so everybody open sourced this stuff and really been working hard to build their communities. And I think that is incredibly cool. So I had to get that out there just because I think that's just like the first statement of
it's almost like an arms race, or like, you know, where Google puts up TensorFlow and so on and so forth. There's been this kind of transition away, you know, taking the conversation again sort of a different direction for a moment. You know, there's been this kind of transition away from CPU big data sort of solutions to more intelligent neural net machine learning oriented applications.
Yeah. Well, this is one of the ones that we're really working on how to make sure that we support in OpenShift as a platform. Back to a little bit to the original question, I think one of the questions is how many pure kind of machine learning type of applications are there going to be? And there'll probably be a fair number. I think a really interesting question is what percentage of all applications are going to have a machine learning component? And I'd say that's going to be high. I bet you'd say half of enterprise applications in a couple of years will have 10% of them have a machine learning component. And that means you need to widely make available those tools and libraries to every developer. And so that's something that we have to make sure that we're doing, you know, on our platforms like OpenShift. Because you can imagine almost anything you do, a need to recognize what's in a picture or to make a judgment on a next step based on a behavior of someone that you're interacting with in an application. And so I the majority of applications are going to have an AI component, and then the standalone, obviously, AI applications will continue to grow and grow and grow.
You know, one of the trends I've noticed is AI, if anyone's played with it over the last, you know, 5-6 years, it was complicated and hard. You needed a PhD, essentially, to figure out how to configure it, deploy it, use it. It was a bit of a mystery. I don't know if the mystery is necessarily gone. It's still a black box, but I think the ability to access it has become, well, more accessible. So you can actually deploy things. And I think platforms like OpenShift probably will provide a nice on-ramp into how you deploy these types of applications in a usable way without having a PhD.
Well, exactly. I do think that's important. You know, you're back to how containers have been around for a long time. They all of a sudden took off. You know, I've observed something similar with Ansible. Mm-hmm. I'm convinced that time to value for a developer is so incredibly important. The reason containers took off with the, I guess now Mobi specification, the Docker specification, was because all of a sudden it got dead simple. As soon as it was dead simple, I can figure it out in 15 minutes, bam, it takes off. I've never seen anything like Ansible. It's just exploded. I really got it thinking about containers, but it's been just a phenomenal automation platform. You go, why? So it's just dead simple. It's easy to use. And I do think as soon as you get a barrier down to time to value to, you know, under an hour, roughly making that up for a developer, all of a sudden, bam, you can get huge adoption. And so again, we don't directly play in AI, but for us, make it dead simple to play with and ultimately embed AI into applications. If we can do that, we'll just, you know, enable an explosion there as well.
You know, the idea of sort of time to value and the adoption curve found in open source seems to be steadily increasing. For example, there's been a lot of talk around Kubernetes being one of the fastest growing open source projects. Previous to Kubernetes, it was Docker being the fastest growing project. It seems that the adoption cycle of technology, specifically around open source technologies, is shrinking. What used to take 10 years is now taking 2 years. And maybe in 2 years, it'll take a year. You know, are you seeing similar types of trends?
Yeah, I think that's happening for a couple of reasons. First off, open source has just gone so mainstream. There's kind of more just kind of thought around things like usability, which I think helps. But I do think as well as these net new technologies add so much value so quickly. Not to pick on something, but like, you know, MySQL, great database, always loved, we've always been supportive, but it was a free alternative to stuff that was already out there. There is no other Kubernetes out there. If you're going to think about containers and orchestrating the scale, that's it. And so I think the fact that open source has gone to really driving net new innovation, if you want to use those technologies, you have no choice but to to use these technologies. And so I think that's really helped to speed the adoption as well. Plus, I'm convinced the world is accelerating so incredibly fast versus, a few years ago. It wasn't the physicist who said, the biggest shortcoming of the human race is our inability to understand the exponential function. And I do think look back 5 years from now and be laughing at how slow things are moving now.
It's crazy. It's just things are just rapidly taking off. Things I found really interesting in the story around OpenShift was your shift into reinvent for the container world.
Yeah, so something I generally believe in that is if at all possible using open source project, it's really, really hard to start open source projects. And so things like OpenStack, people will complain, well, Red Hat was we're going to see what emerges, the default choice. And then we got involved and jumped in and we contribute to. And so when we first started OpenShift, there really weren't a set of mature projects around this PaaS thing, but we were hearing a lot of customer demand for it. So we started to build our own. And frankly, after we built it, they were all open source, but still, the kind of the nexus of participation ended up around Docker and Kubernetes. And one of the things I think is a real strength of Red Hat is we don't get overwedded to a technology. We are overwedded to the production system. This is, kind of getting bigger, growing faster than, the things we were doing. We adopted them, right? That's what we do.
So your benchmark, the metric you look for within a opportunity is the size and scope of a community, the sort of how quickly it's growing, the activity around it. OpenStack being probably a good example. It grew quickly. vibrant ecosystem of companies involved?
Yeah, so it's twofold. For us, you know, first off, open source is all about user-driven innovation. And so if you don't have users involved and have a vibrant community, I mean, it'd be nice to say, let's give away all our source code, but you know, as a commercial business, the reason we give away all our source code is we believe in the power of participation. Well, if nobody else is participating, that doesn't make a lot of sense, right? So we like to involve large participative communities. So we like that. On the other side, we look and say, okay, does this meet the enterprise need? And if it then so you gotta have that too. And then third, we have to say, is this a place where we have a vibrant technology and enterprise need that our model works? This productization, you know, 10-year life cycle, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Because not all products make sense to have the enterprise life cycle that we put into the product. So we kind of look and say, do we have a cool hammer here? Is there a need for a hammer? And, you know, is there a nail, right? And so those three things have to work together for us to ultimately come to market. And I think that one of the reasons Red Hat's been unique open source is we're passionate about existing open source communities, we're creating our own, and we're very disciplined for saying, oh, XYZ might be really, really interesting, but that our model's not gonna work. Customers may love it, but our model's not gonna work, so let's stay away from it. And you put that together, that's why we've been uniquely successful.
What advice do you have someone looking to create an open source project? They're sitting in their basement, you know, plugging away in some code. What would you suggest to them?
I would say, rather than necessarily think you're gonna start one, I would say, look around and see what's out there that you think that you can participate in and take a lead in over time. You know, again, there's participation. One of the things we do is user-driven. We like to see true users of a technology being in business. They're more likely to be, right? And there's a ton of those out there. There are, 2 million open projects. So I'm really people who do it. An interesting technology where you think you can add some true net value to that. And I mean, I think a lot of the users would love to have somebody commercialize. There are a couple of the big web companies I'll actually go talk to because they buy from us. But the conversations are about them selling me on why we ought to commercialize some of their projects.
Okay.
Right? Because the simple reason is they would say, well, hey, that gives us more people contributing, and now we have a company that'll life cycle it for us, so that reduces our support costs of doing it internally, and et cetera, et cetera. So involved in a project doesn't mean that you can't commercialize it. Matter of fact, I think many open source projects would love to have somebody come commercialize it because it just builds the ecosystem.
What open source projects right now get you excited? You know, something you saw that might be, you know, what's interesting to you?
Well, to me, some of the, and again, this is because these are close to the things that we're doing. I think solving the data problems on containers is a deal. So containers are clearly a better way to develop applications for a whole bunch of reasons. How you scale out data, how you think about data in hybrid deployment models, we're still in the earlier days of that. You know, you get clouds, you know, like Google with things like Spanner, but solutions that enterprises can think about, or, you know, individual companies can think about, there needs to be a lot of work done there. Really look hard. We have great relationships. People like, you know, Couchbase works with us on OpenShift, and a lot of customers love it. So there's some interesting things out there, but there's still a lot of problems, especially at the data layer. I would say if you're really looking for some new ideas, when you start thinking about how people are moving towards containers and the power of containers and microservices, and by the way, when you get into it, I think microservices are so impactful because it's the first time you have economic reuse. Reuse of software has been holy grail.
Yeah.
And you know, people tried SOA, but SOA is so expensive. Even in virtualization, it's expensive. Well, microservices, all of a sudden, you can really think about reuse in a cool way. But now imagine you're an enterprise and you have 500 enterprise applications. Those are now instantiated in 2.3 million running containers. And well, let's say application performance issue. How are you gonna figure that out, right? How are you gonna debug that? So when you think about this move from traditional monolithic applications to containerized microservices, there will be 1,000 problems with that that we're gonna need software and tools to fix and monitor and telemetry and all that other stuff. And problems that some people I'm sure are thinking about, but a lot that have not been solved yet. So area, if you want to say net new. In the same way, you know, the analogy I often use, you know, VMware exists because when you move from a physical to virtual data center, you need a new paradigm of management, and VMware was there to kind of develop that paradigm for a virtualized data center. They were at the epicenter of virtualization in the early days. I think when you go from monolithic to microservices for applications, there's going to be a whole new paradigm, not necessarily one company, I mean that, but there's a whole new paradigm for how you're going to manage in that world. And
in the future, but making it happen as well. She's off screen here, but again, I think you guys are throwing a party at the baseball park, Fenway.
Tomorrow night at Fenway. I hope you can join us.
Yeah,
we have a few thousand seats there for our closest friends.
Oh yeah, it's actual game, right?
Absolutely.
Who are they playing?
The Orioles.
I'm sure our friends from Baltimore. We'll appreciate it. All right. Well, it's been a pleasure. Thanks again for giving me the opportunity.
This was great. Enjoyed it.
All right. And this is Ruben from the Red Hat Summit in Boston, signing off.